So hello everyone, I'm Akanksha and I'm from Rakuten Institute of Technology and I know a little in detail about what we do. And today I'll talk a bit about, just give an overview of interpretable machine learning and how we're trying to use that in our daily analysis. So quickly how the content would be, I'd first give a brief introduction about myself and the company I work for. Then I'll start with a bit of a story on how we actually sort of started looking into and why we started looking into model interpretation. Then I'll give a brief overview of the landscape as of now and as of what I know. And I'll roughly again go through one of the techniques that we're using. It's called sharp values. I'll finally sort of conclude the story with some examples of how we've used it. And then I'll go to some resources, which could be, some of them are really good resources, which could be useful for anyone who's sort of interested in taking up further and then following up. So let me real quick about me. So I've, in my previous life, actually worked as a software engineer for Adobe, for their print analytics. Post that, I actually worked as a researcher in NUS. I actually did my master's by research at NUS. Where I work pretty much on social media stuff, so summarizing large social media documents and so on. And for the past few years, I've been working at Rakuten, and specifically in their data science unit, which is called RIT. And my focus is a lot on user behavior. So it deals with, I work a lot with marketing as well as product. So identifying drivers for customer churn, acquisition, building prediction models for the same. I do a bit of marketing, budgeting, and attribution as well. And I also do a lot of growth experiments, something we recently started, where I work with design and product to sort of run these experiments and analyze them. A quick intro about Rakuten. So I'm not sure how many of you know about Rakuten, but it's a very big e-commerce player in Japan. Though it's Japanese, but it's actually pretty much a global company. The Rakuten Group itself has a lot of companies in Americas, it has presence in Europe and even in Asia. And Rakuten Institute of Technology is really a very, it's a very interesting position because it's a horizontal, that sort of sits across all these companies. So as and when these companies have needs that require data science or some data inputs, members in RIT sort of work with them and collaborate with these individual companies. So, and we have really diverse projects and diverse companies. For instance, Rakuten is into e-commerce, it's into payments, it's into even like golf renting, it's into travel, it's into video streaming. So it's got all sorts of really nice data, and we have really nice people in RIT working on areas from machine translation, that we have Lillian here, who's like our senior scientist on machine translation. We have voice recognition, a lot of stuff around image. We have AR, VR, like tons of stuff if you guys are interested. Anyways, so I've been pretty much involved in this whole Rakuten system. I've been involved with Rakuten Viki, which is essentially a video streaming platform that streams mostly Asian content. So Asian meaning Korean and Chinese. And most of their markets, so if you're wondering why in SG you don't see a lot of shows on wiki.com, it's because most of these good content is licensed for the Americas or the Europe. So that's their main audience. But they have a very big R&D and engineering presence here in the Singapore office. And their business model is pretty much like Hulu in the US, if you're aware of that. So they have a free platform where users sort of watch stuff for free, but they earn money through ads. And there's also a subscription-based system where users pay a monthly recurring fee, but then and let go of the ads. And so let me start off with the story. So, like I said, they have a subscription-based plan. So here my focus is on the subscription-based part of the business. And you have customers coming in monthly, paying to watch content. So that's yay for the company, the dollars in. But then you also have customers leaving the subscription, and that's like not good because, again, that's dollars out. So when one fine day, the management decides to go to marketing and they're like, hey, why don't we start using AI to identify which customers are going to churn next? And marketing is really excited, like, oh yeah, sure, let's start using that. So then they come to me and they're like, can you help us identify who will churn next month? And I'm like, sure, like, you know, I can use past data and I can try to build a model that will predict who will churn next. Fair enough. So I get all, you know, excited, I go to the data, all the usual feature, data cleaning, engineering, you know, building features and, you know, different features like video viewing, click stream, subscription behavior. And we train this on the past. And then I come up with a probability score for the users who are going to churn next month. And I sort of work on this model, try out different models, and eventually there's a model that works on gradient boosted trees and is performing better than the baseline that they have. So I'm really excited and I give this score to marketing and let's see what happens. So the time goes by, like I think almost a month or so, I started looking at some other projects because I thought it'd take time to test it out and then, you know, experiment with it, but nothing's really happening. And I'm like, okay, what's happening, what's wrong? And just to mention here that quite a few companies which are probably just starting out with data science, this is the part where when POC comes out from the data team and no action is taken, then the POC sort of dies. So what we guys did was we sort of thought, let's see whether there's another side to the story. So we went to marketing and it turns out it was, their problem was really simple. They're like, okay, you've given me this score, what do I do with it? And why should I do what I do with this score? So we realized something that we should have probably realized back, that if marketing is unable to action on these predictions, then the model won't be used. So typically what we were giving marketing was, we had a model in place, and like you have customer XYZ, and I'm giving a number assigned to that. So YZ have a higher score to churn as compared to X. But what if we could also sort of give an explanation along with each prediction, saying that, let's say customer Y is someone who's, you know, a fairly recent subscriber, subscribed again this month, but has a history of, you know, subscribing and canceling. And another one is going to cancel because he's someone who's lost interest now. So that's when we actually started looking at model interpretation. And this is a fairly new field in the sense that sometimes even the definition of the word model interpretation is sort of contested. But roughly, it is how humans can understand the choices that are made by the model in their decision-making process. So after this, I'll give a bit of an overview of what's there these days in terms of model interpretation, a very high level. So typically, when we talk of the landscape of interpretability. So first we have models that are inherently interpretable. So my regressions where I can interpret the weights or simple decision trees. Then we have something called surrogate models, and I'll go into that a little more in detail, which essentially what they do is, we already have a very complex model train. They train another simple interpretable model on this, on the predictions of these complex models. And then eventually there's a lot of research also going around how you visualize these explanations so that it's easy for the end user to understand. Some of these which are at a global level, like your partial dependence plots and all, I guess some of you might have already used. So I won't go into too much detail into this one. I'll focus more on the surrogate models. Just a bit of textuality that's there. So typically, model interpretation techniques can be classified either as local or global. So global is something that we're trying to explain over the entire data set, whereas local is one that we're trying to explain for one particular prediction. You can also classify them as model specific or model agnostic. So model specific is one that's limited to specific model classes, like interpreting of regression weights in a linear model. Whereas model agnostic techniques are one that can be used on any machine learning model. and they are usually applied post hoc after you've already trained the model. Okay, so this is again a very, very high level and view of the different techniques out there. I won't touch on the model specific ones, and in the model agnostic ones, I typically focus on the surrogate models as the last few. The others, I have a lot of resources at the end. Anyone who's interested, we can always look them up. So I go to surrogate models. So the basic idea behind these is that, say you have a really complex machine learning model. You train this and they have a complex neural net. And what we then do is we train another single model on the original inputs and the predicted target value of my complex model. And then that's how I interpret these decisions. One of them is, it's been out there for a while. It's really popular. Some of you might have even used it. It's called LINE, which is a local interpretable model agnostic explanation model. Local means it's doing it for each individual instance. Model agnostic means you can sort of plug it into any underlying complex model that's making decisions for you. And again, at a very high level, it's definitely more sophisticated than what I have here, but in the interest of time. So what you do is you select your instance of interest and you sort of perturb your data set and get predictions for new points. So in this case, if my the point of interest is the bright red one, I essentially get new data points around this. And then what I do is I weight these new samples by the distance to my point of interest. And then I train a weighted interpretable model on this data set with these variations. And then I explain this model. The problem with this method is that, actually there are quite a few. I have referenced at the back that you can refer to. One of the main problems is how do you define this neighborhood around this instance? And believe it or not, currently the number is hard-coded in the LINE code. So if you actually go to the LINE repo and see that number is hard-coded. And I sort of tried playing around with it, and for different sort of use cases, it seemed to require some sort of tuning. So if anyone wants to play with it, they already have an R library as well as a Python library, so I would suggest you keep this hard coding in mind when you're using this model and then play around with it. Another thing that's sort of a problem across interpretation is correlation of features. That's something that's even there, say, simple interpretable models like regression. The two features are correlated, how do you sort of interpret them? And recently another work came out, which is an article, it's on archive right now, which has actually shown the instability of this model. So what do I mean by instability is that the authors actually conducted experiments where two explanations that are really close, the explanation, the points were really close, but the explanations varied a great deal. So this is something to keep to watch out for. I'll move on to another technique that's called SHAP, which is the most recent work on model interpretation. And what it does is it unifies several previous methods. What I mean by that is it sort of says that there are currently existing methods, such as LIME and deeplift. And it basically says that all these methods is able to prove that they belong to a particular class. They all belong to the same class. And if this class was to satisfy certain properties, again, I won't go into the details, but these are properties that are important for interpretability. You guys can go through it. I mean, we can go through it later if you guys have time. So if this class has to satisfy these properties, there's only one unique solution that's possible. And this unique solution, they say, is given by these Shapley values. So this big, really big looking formula is how Shapley values are derived. But the details, you can go to the next paper, but I really give some sort of an intuition on how, what these mean. And these values actually come from game theory, and what these guys, what Trap the paper tries to do is it tries to connect game theory with model interpretation. So rough, at a high level, what game theory does is that, say I have a team that's making $400 in profit, and I have three people working on it. How do I attribute an individual's contribution to this team? That's the question that game theory is trying to answer. And it, again, in a very high level point of view, how it does is it sort of takes all possible team permutations as a normalizing weight for them. So once we know the individual when a team is working alone, and we know, say, a contribution of two players, then I can find the counterfactual gain of a member when he's working in this team. So for instance, A, in a team that's contributing 400, I'll find his contribution as 400 minus 100, which is actually B's contribution when B's just working alone. Similarly for B, B's contribution would be 400 minus 200, and 200 was actually A's contribution when he was working alone. So in this way, you can essentially find out what is each team member's contribution across teams of different sizes, and you sort of normalize this and eventually get how much you attribute to each individual member. So how does this relate to model interpretation? Well, essentially, you can envision these individual team members as being the features of a prediction. And the amount that they're actually contributing is my prediction that's above the base value. So if my base is 0.5, that's my average prediction, random prediction without any using features, then my gain is 0.78 minus 0.5. So actually, you think of this overall sales as you know, the prediction score above my base value. So that's how you sort of, at a very high level, draw an analogy between game theory and interpreting my model's prediction. So this is what we eventually used. And this is what the results on our sort of data look like. So previously, what we gave to marketing for a particular prediction was this score. So for this user, you have a score of 0.71. But using model interpretation, this is sharp values, what we were actually able to give was a reason as to why we are saying this score is higher than the base value. So he's subscribed for less than a month. He's not viewed much content, and he's someone who seems to have canceled a lot in the past. Versus a user that has a lower prediction than the base value, you can see he's someone who's been there for a while and he's viewed a lot of content. In fact, he's just watched content. He's been fairly active. And another thing you can do is, if I were to take all these, let's just say, horizontal explanations, flip them vertically, and kind of stack them together, I can actually see my users together in one go. So for instance, I have this set of new users who are not watching any content. They have my set of disengaged users over here. And one thing it sort of, I didn't expect it to do, but it also helped me in qualitatively evaluating my model. So there was this particular area where it didn't make sense to me. So these users are not probably likely to churn, but then I see very weird features being attributed to that, saying that they had a lot of drop in their minutes viewed, they had more lot of content in the past, and it actually made me go back and revisit my model and data. And I sort of realized the data was unclean. My queries were off for some of these. So I actually managed to correct some of this. So instead of just cranking up my accuracy, I actually sort of qualitatively got to see what's happening in here. So Shaki is great, but again, correlated features is also an issue here when you're sort of attributing it. The article that I referred to, it's recently been out, again argued for the fact that some of the explanations, even for sharp values, were not stable, though they were more stable than line. And also, sort of a trade-off between sharp and line is that sharp sort of builds a prediction model. So you can do things like, you can do regression such as, if I change my feature by this much, how much will the output change? But for the Shapley values feature attributions, you can't really do that sort of a modeling. So if you say denying someone a loan, with probably in the future with that, you can say, so your income is less than 10,000, but maybe if you increase it to this much, your loan would be approved. So there are things like that which you potentially right now cannot do with Shapley. This has a very good implementation. There's an R library available, though I haven't tried it. The Python one is really good. And the good thing is that the author is very active and on GitHub. He's open to contributions as well as to answering questions. So in summary, what I would potentially like you guys to take away would be that it's possible if you're building stuff, especially for marketing or some other business stakeholders, they might, especially if we're not familiar with how predictive modeling works, they might not take action on the predictions unless they have some more reason to trust your model. And in such situations, model interpretation could help you. Currently, the method of using local surrogate models such as Lime and CAP seems to be the way. It seems to be promising. But as a caution, it's still in development phase. So there are a lot of problems that still need to be solved. So, I mean, you can use it to explain to a layperson what's happening, but for a heavily regulated system, like, you know, if you're answerable to the monetary authority about why you're denying a loan, I probably wouldn't use them right away. Yeah, there's still a lot of work to do, but like I said, this means there's scope for us to contribute. So if any of you guys are actually interested in this, you can, the authors are all very responsive and we help, and you can just, I mean, one of them actually wrote down a math equation for me and sent me an email, so they're really responsive. So I'll touch on some resources, and they're really good. There's this book by a PhD grad student. His name is Christoph. It's really good. In fact, some of the content, like the structure of how I want to do it, was through this book. He has also very interesting stories, like Black Mirror kind of stories to start the book with, and what would happen if we don't interpret our models. It's a nice read. It's also very concise and to the point. And for cases where you should be going out, like he refers you to, you know, papers and everything, really good. Kaggle also came up with a machine learning explainability course, if anyone's interested, but that's kind of shorter. And there are also very nice tips on, you know, sort of getting interpretability practices in your machine learning process. This is by h2o.ai. Very nice stuff about how you should constantly test models for sensitivity and you know, a couple of other tips, really useful. Then this is the original line paper, then they've also got a YouTube video explaining it in short. Again, you have the sharp value, this is the guy's GitHub code base. Really good, really useful, have a look. This is his NIPS paper that came out, and he actually also came up with another paper specifically for ensemble trees. Because you see, when you're doing all this feature permutation, there's so many features, so many permutations, it can get computationally intensive. So he's actually come up with a faster method of doing it, specifically for trees. You can have a look. The robustness paper that I was mentioning, there's the link to that one there. Have a look for that as well. And if you're specifically looking for experts in Singapore, I don't claim any expertise in this area. I'm sort of exploring this and trying to incorporate this in my, you know, machine learning process and see, you know, business stakeholders can find it useful. But there is this lab called Ubiquitous Computing Lab in NUS. You can check out their link. They're doing some really nice stuff, right from visualization to actually working on these models. And the grad student who actually introduced to me was actually a former master's student by research. So that's his website if you're interested. And funny thing, I actually asked him whether I could put this on slide last week, and he actually said he's doing a meetup. He's starting a meetup himself on explainable artificial intelligence. So if any of you are interested, it's happening next week on April 4. I think he has a really small room book because he doesn't expect a lot of people. It's a first meetup, but I guess if you guys are really interested and you get on the wait list, he's probably willing to get a bigger venue, or maybe he can talk next here. He's one of the really good, like, the experts in this. He's the one sort of guided me to start using it. And definitely, if you guys have questions, feedbacks, or any sort of collaboration that you would want, my LinkedIn is already there. The link is there in the meetup as well. But this is my personal email as well as my company email. If you guys want to get in touch with, I'll be more than happy to work on some problems together. It's a very interesting area. And finally, Rakuten is hiring. Reason my manager got me here. Kidding. So Rakuten is hiring. So if you guys are interested, it's across the board. Engineering, just full stack engineering, specifically data engineering, data scientists, senior scientists, across the board. Like I said, it's a diverse company. There are loads of problems, loads of data sets to work on. So if you guys are interested, please go and check it out. I think this year. So thank you. If you guys have any questions, I'll definitely try to answer to my best, as much as I know of this field. Thank you. Okay. So I mean, you guys, I hope I didn't bore you. you guys can reach out to me later on LinkedIn or like my addresses. I'll probably hand over the slides to the organizers so you can have them. I'll confirm with my company once again some of the examples for internal. But just reach out to me or to these guys at NUS for trying to do some stuff on interpretation and have fun with it. It's a nice, it's a very interesting course if you go through this GitHub code. Okay, thank you.